Hi, my name is Connie O'Clanis and you're watching the video on the Synoptophore and how we utilise this instrument to assess a patient's BSV. As I mentioned in previous videos, we can assess worst three grades of binocular single vision using the Synoptophore. So we can assess grade 1, simultaneous perception, grade 2, fusion, and grade 3, stereopsis. And we assess the three grades in that specific order when using the Synoptophore. So let's begin with grade 1, simultaneous perception. For this we use specific slides. They're usually red in colour, and what we see is that the slide that goes in front of one eye is completely different to that which will go in front of the other eye. But they are pairs. So here as an example we have a lion and a cage. And so what we'll be asking of this patient is to put the lion in the cage. And again, here we have a fish and a fish tank. So we'll be asking the patient to put the fish in the tank. So whilst the images are completely different, they are paired in a way that you'll be able to ask a question of your patient in terms of superimposing those particular images. So let's say, for example, we put the lion in front of the right eye and the cage in front of the left eye. In order for simultaneous perception to be present, then the patient must indicate that they see both the lion and the cage at the same time. If one is missing, then we have suppression, and we can work out which eye is suppressed because we know which slide we put in front of which eye. So in this instance, if the lion was missing and the patient could only see the cage, well, then there's right suppression. Okay, beyond just the presence or absence of simultaneous perception, we can measure the size of a patient's deviation using the Synoptophore with the simultaneous perception slides. We can measure the deviation both objectively and subjectively. Let's begin subjectively and assume we're using the slides of the lion and the cage. Subjectively, in order for the patient to perceive that the lion is superimposed on top of the cage or the lion is in the cage, the lion must fall on the fovea of the right eye and the cage must fall in front of the fovea of the left eye. So if a patient, as an example, has a right esotropia, then when you commence the test, the lion will not be in the cage because whilst the patient is looking through the tubes, the cage will fall on the fovea of the left eye, but because this is set at zero, the cage will fall on the contralateral image point. And so what we ask of the patient is to take this lever and move it forwards and backwards until they put the lion in the cage. And they will progressively move this lion until it projects onto the fovea of the right eye. And when that lion projects on the fovea of the right eye, then the patient will indicate that the lion is in the cage. Okay, if the patient moves the lever forwards, we have an esodeviation. And if the patient moves the lever backwards, we have an exodeviation. And we can read the size of the deviation off the scale, the horizontal scale. And over here is a magnification of this scale here. So here we have zero. If we moved the Synoptophore forwards, we would have an esodeviation. And if we moved the tube backwards, then we would have had an exodeviation. Now let's assume that the patient has abnormal retinal correspondence. On what point on the retina do you think the patient will want the cage to project onto? Do you think they'll want it on the fovea or on the pseudofovea? They will want it on the pseudofovea. Whilst the Synoptophore is a haploscope and each eye is individually seeing one image, the patient is binocular. So It is the pseudophobia that has principal visual direction and which acts as the fovea under binocular conditions. So in order for the line to be in the cage for a patient with ARC, subjectively, the patient will move that lion so that it projects on pseudophobia, not on the true fovea. And this is why we always measure the deviation subjectively to see whether the patient puts the lion on the true fovea or whether they prefer another retinal position. And if they prefer another retinal position other than the true fovea, then there's an indication here that abnormal retinal correspondence is present. Okay, how do we go about assessing the angle of deviation objectively? We will need to perform a cover test using the Synoptophore. Let's take the example of a patient with a right esotropia and the line in front of the right eye. When I shut off the left light, I will see the right eye come out to take up fixation. So what I will do is take the lever, move it forward, and repeat the cover test. And I will continue to move this horizontal lever until I see that when I shut off the left light, there is no longer any movement of the right eye because the line now projects on the fovea. Now note that objectively what you're doing as you're performing this cover test and observing the eye movement or the eye taking up fixation, you will be moving the lion towards the fovea, and the point in time that you see no movement of the eye is the point of where the fovea is located, the true fovea. So objectively, you will be locating the true fovea always. You will never put the image on the pseudophobia, as that relies on a subjective response from the patient. Now, should your patient have a vertical deviation, then just as with the horizontal, you'll move this vertical deviation control until you see no movement of the eye. Subjectively, you'll move this for the patient and just ask them when the line is in the cage. So in terms of the slides, in the end, subjectively, the patient should have this line in the center of the cage. If he's too high or too low, then you have a vertical deviation. So with the simultaneous perception slides, you need to ask your patient about the position of the line in relation to the cage, and again determine if there is horizontal separation as well as whether there's vertical separation. We can also measure or map the suppression scotoma when utilizing the simultaneous perception slides. Earlier I mentioned that if a patient cannot see one of the slides, then this is an indication that suppression is present. And so what we can do is map the area of where the patient has or can only see one slide versus the areas where the patient can see the two slides. Let's say, for example, here at zero, the patient sees only the cage and cannot see the lion. Well, then I'd move this forward until the patient tells me that the lion appears. And then I'll go backwards and ask the patient when the lion appears. And so the area where the lion is absent is the suppression scotoma. And I'll show you in a subsequent video how we go about mapping that suppression scotoma on a projection diagram. Once you've completed assessing simultaneous perception, you can now progress to assessing a patient's fusion. And the Synoptophore can tell us about sensory fusion, and it can actually measure motor fusion. To do this, we use fusion slides. For these slides, we have a common image and then some distinct differences. So if we can see here, we've got a rabbit, the same rabbit in this slide as in this slide. But this slide, the rabbit is holding flowers. And for this slide, the rabbit has a tail. In the example here, we have a bear and there's honey on his head. And it's the same bear here, but this time they're standing on a stool. So in order for us to assess sensory fusion, obviously we want to have the same images to see whether they can fuse those two images. But then we need a level of control so we know if they see one because they're binocular or do they see one because of suppression. And that's where the controls play a role. If the patient can see one rabbit and that rabbit is holding the flowers and has a tail, then we have sensory fusion. If, however, the patient can only see the rabbit with the flowers and indicates the rabbit has no tail, then there is suppression. And if, for example, it's this slide with the tail that was in the left slide holder, then they have left suppression. Now, in order for you to assess sensory fusion or even motor fusion, you must commence the assessment at the subjective angle of the patient. What this means is that you mustn't return your levers to zero or your dials to zero to commence the assessment of fusion or at the commencement of the assessment of fusion. What you want to do is leave the handles and dials at the subjective angle of the patient. So if, for example, on simultaneous perception assessment, you found that there was a 5-degree ESO and you had moved this handle forward, then you commence fusion with that handle 5 degrees forward. You do not put it back at zero. Why? Because we need the image to fall on the fovea of the right eye and the fovea of the left eye. And when you assess the first grade of BSV on the synoptophore, you located the fovea or the pseudofovea if the patient has ARC. Now, how do we progress to the fusion range? First, we establish if the patient has sensory fusion, then we move on to measuring the fusion range. Here is the handle for the fusion range. And when you rotate this, what you'll find is that these tubes will converge and diverge, and you will be able to see your patient's eyes converge and diverge as you move these tubes. To assess fusion, you need to lock both tubes. This is the lock here for this one and this here, so that they can move together in response to you moving this dial here. Okay, and above here, can't quite see it, is the scale that you'll read off in terms of the fusion range. And here we have a close-up of that scale. This is our 0.4 when we assess divergence. Each line is 1 degree. So say, for instance, the patient broke at this point here, then we count how many lines and we determine how many degrees of fusion or divergence was achieved. What's the question we ask the patient whilst we observe the eyes? Well, once they break, what will happen is the rabbit will become two rabbits, one holding flowers and one with a tail. So what we ask the patient is, when do you see two rabbits if they're the slides you've used? Now, remember when we talked about the prism fusion range, some patients don't experience diplopia on break, some suppress. So the other question you ask your patient is, tell me when you see two rabbits or when the flowers disappear or when the tail disappears. In this instance, you'll have suppression. So break point should be determined subjectively by the patient, indicating that they see either two rabbits or they've lost one of the control measures. In addition to this, you'll also be able to observe the break. Once the patient has broken, you should actually return in the opposite direction and see when the patient recovers BSV again, just as you do for the prism fusion range. Okay, in doing that, you're assessing the horizontal vergences. You can assess both fusional divergence and convergence. You can also assess vertical fusion ranges for the patient. In this instance, you would start to manipulate the vertical dial and raise or lower the slide until the patient says that they see two rabbits, or the flower disappears, or the tail disappears. Similarly, you can measure cyclofusion by using the torsion control here and determining when the patient can no longer maintain binocular single vision. And lastly, we have stereopsis. Here we have fusion slides, and this time the images are the same, except that there is disparity present. So we can see here that this circle is located outwards to the left, and this circle here is located outwards to the right. And this disparity will create depth in the stereopsis. Here we have five balls, and we can see that the cross on each ball is located slightly differently, so that disparity is created. And in this instance, each of the balls will be located in a different place in space, in the sense that one of those balls, let's say for example, the yellow one, will be more forwards, and the blue one will be the one that's further behind. Now, with the stereopsis testing on the Synoptophore, we don't actually measure stereo acuity. It's a gross stereopsis test, and we're simply detecting the presence or absence of stereopsis. In terms of the actual assessment and what we ask the patients when assessing stereopsis, well, this will depend on the slides that you provide the patient. But for example, if you present these slides here, which I call the buckets, the inner circle here, or the base of the bucket, will be either towards the examiner or pushed towards the patient. So in putting them in the slide holders, I'll then ask the question as to whether the buckets are towards me or towards them. And I will repeat this a few times so that I can gain confidence that the patient does have stereopsis. So on one occasion I might have them towards me, on another occasion I may have them towards them. If on the other hand you use these slides here, where you have five circles, then you'll have to ask the patient which of the circles is closest to you. You could also ask to order the circles from that which is closest to the examiner to that which is closest to them as the patient. You should then flip them, and the answer should reverse. So if it was the yellow that was closest to the examiner, and then the slides are flipped, the yellow should now be closest to the patient. In terms of recording, we record our findings from our assessment of each grade of binocular single vision. So you'll see here we've got a Synoptophore result with the objective angle and the subjective angle documented. Here we have an indication the patient was fixing right, so the right tube was locked, and there was a 10 degree eso deviation in the left on right, and then the patient has also indicated that the line is in the cage, fixing right when the handle is placed at 12 degrees eso, and a left on right of 8 diopters is corrected. Fusion is demonstrated, and here we have a minus 10 degree fusional divergence to plus 20 degrees fusional convergence. And in this instance, only break was recorded and recovery was not. And with SV, this stands for stereo vision, and a tick's been given that it is present. Here's another example where we've got, again, the objective angle being indicated, fixing left, and we've also been told what slides were used here. It's an indication foveal slides were used. For subjective angle, the patient had right suppression, and this is not a mapping of the right suppression, just an indication that the right eye was suppressed. And then we have that fusion was not demonstrated and stereo vision was not demonstrated. Now, before we conclude, I just want to come back to how the Synoptophore assists us with determining if a patient has potential binocular single vision. Let's take an example of a patient with a large right esotropia, or an esotropia, let's say, of 30 diopters. In free space, that patient has diplopia, and as such, the only way in free space to determine if they've got potential for binocular single vision is utilising a test such as the prism subjective. With the synoptophore, when we place the patient on the synoptophore, when we move the horizontal lever to correct for the 30 diopter ET, then what we're effectively doing is simulating a fovea to fovea situation, because the image, say the cage will fall on the fovea of one eye, and the image of the lion will now fall on the fovea of the other eye, because you've rotated the tube so that that image, or the image of the lion, now falls on fovea. And so this is what then allows us to then progress to the next stage of fusion and seeing whether the patient has fusion under that simulated condition of being bifoveal. Okay, and then also we can progress to looking at whether the patient has stereo vision. So the synoptophore is a great test in determining potential post-op outcomes and the possibility of whether a patient may achieve binocular single vision post-operatively. Okay, that brings us to the conclusion of this video. Thank you for watching.